Hi there, my name is Irene, and in this video, we're going to talk about Revit levels, one of the most important elements to set up before you can get started developing your architectural shell for your project. So let's get to it. All right, so we are in a default Revit template. The unit system has been set up for Imperial. And the first thing that is important to mention is the fact that levels are datum. They are not geometry, so they are not real-world objects, so to speak. The second most important thing to mention is that you're not going to be able to create levels in a floor plan view. In fact, if you go to your architecture tab where you can find your levels, you're going to see that they are grayed out. And that is because levels are a datum element that informs the height of different elements in your project. So in order to see levels, you need to be working either on an elevated view or on a 3D view. My preference is to work on an elevated view, whether it's a section or an elevation, just because the 3D view can, like the perspective can cause some issues. So I'm going to select any of my elevations from the default views that come with the template. Let's just go with the south. And now here are my levels. Now, I think I mentioned this in my previous video about like the intro to Revit, but basically depending on what template you choose, you're going to get different settings. With the default template, you will always get two levels. They are going to be called level 1 and level 2. And if you're working with Imperial, the heights are going to be 0 feet and 10 feet. Now, the first thing that I want to talk about a little bit is what do these levels reference? Because this can vary depending on the nature of your project. So in construction, in general, levels indicate the height with respect to the ground level, so where the soil is, the height of slabs. So whether your slabs are made out of concrete or whether they are made out of wood or whether they are made out of Doritos, it doesn't matter. It basically counts the horizontal elements that make your project. And the reason that I refer to it as either slabs or horizontal elements is because your levels will not just account for floors, they will also account for roofs. And in fact, there's a bunch of other things that levels can reference, but it's always going to be these like key horizontal elements. Also keep in mind that levels can go up and they can also go down. If you're doing something like an underground parking or something like that, your levels are going to be infrastructure. They're going to be below the grade zero. Okay, so when you see here, these level one at zero, this is telling me that this is where the soil would be, where your grade is, and then you go up from there. Now, in the context of interior design, you're not really working with the outside. This is why we call it interior, because it's interior design. So usually in the context of interior design, we will refer to our zero level as the lower point in the project, because think about it, you could have a project that is maybe a condo or a shop that is within a larger building, and maybe you are in the fifth floor, but you don't care about all those levels below. So in the context of interior design, we're still going to be referring to these horizontal elements, but usually your level one, your zero, is going to be your main floor, so to speak. So now that we understand what purpose levels serve in the context of construction, let's talk about what purpose they serve in the context of Revit. So I think I talked about this in a previous video, but levels are actually super important in Revit because what's going to happen is that most geometry that you create is going to be attached to a level. Hell, views are based on levels. So your levels are kind of like the main driving force of your project. Think about it. If you look at your project browser, your floor plans and ceiling plans are based on the number of levels. But also when you go to place geometry, things like walls, floors, ceilings, roofs, they are all going to be based on a level, whether it's like for the entire geometry or to define the beginning and end of that geometry. And usually when you're placing other things like other components, they are going to be based on a host level, so to speak. So overall, levels should not be overlooked when you're setting up your project. So what can we do with the levels that we have here? So first thing first, you can change the name of your levels. If you don't like them as level 1 and level 2, because that doesn't mean anything to you, you can rename them to something that has a greater meaning. So for example, in the context of interior design, usually because you're working with an interior space, your level 1 is not going to be level 1. It's going to be your AFF or FF, which basically means above finished floor. So if you want to change the name of a level, all you have to do is click, and that is going to highlight the possibility of changing the name. So I'm going to rename my level 1 to AFF. There you go. Now, very important, when I press enter, I'm going to get this message. This message is telling me, hey, remember how I said that levels were super important? Well, I wasn't joking. If you change the name of your levels, you can also potentially change the name of your views. So here it's telling me, hey, you have two views, the floor plan and the ceiling plan views that are based on that level one name. Do you want to rename them? And what I'm going to recommend here in the context of interior design is that you do not rename the views. Because the thing is that I don't necessarily need my level one floor plan to be called AFF. It's just going to be like my main floor, or it's going to be like floor main, like a whole host of names. AFF is not a good name for a top view. So one thing that you can do in Revit is you can have different names for your views that are based on a level versus the level itself. So usually for your floor level, you're going to refer to it as AFF or FF. And your above level is usually going to be called something along the lines of underslab. And the reason for that is because keep in mind, when you are working with an interior project, you don't really care so much about the slab itself because it may not pertain to the scope of your work. If you're working with a multi-level project, that's a different story, and we're going to tackle that in a different video. But if you're working with like a single level project, basically, the top of your project is going to be whatever the slab stops you from being able to design, right? So usually we will refer to this as the underslab. So I can, once again, click once on the title, click a second time, and that activates overriding the name. And I'm going to call this guy, is usually U/S for underslab. Sometimes they also refer to it as plenum. Again, the names can be all over the place. If you use a different name in your business or in your company or something like that, I am super curious to hear about it because I know that things are done very differently in different countries with different methods of construction, with different rules. So leave it in the comments. How do you refer to like the bottom of your project and the top of your project? It's going to be fun. So I'm going to press enter and same thing. I do not want to rename my views to these underslab because it's not going to make any sense. So I'm going to say no. So that's the first thing that you can change about levels. You can change their names. The other thing that you can change is their heights. So again, by default with Imperial, you start with 0 feet and 10 feet. But let's say that I need this to be like, I don't know, 8 feet. So if I want to change the height of my level, I can go where the numerical value is and I'm going to click and I can go 8 feet, enter. And that's going to change the position of my level. Keep in mind that if I would have had any walls or floors or ceilings or whatever that are attached to those levels, all of those things would have moved down with my level if we did things correctly. Now, what happens if we want to add more levels? What if I have another level above this one or another level beneath this one? So if you want to add levels to your project, the way that you're going to do that is either go to the architecture tab and then you're going to see your level, or quick key LL. So LL, and now I am on the level command. One very important thing that I want to highlight before you start creating your levels is that on the modification options, you have this option here checked off by default, which is the option to create plan views. So if this is off, you're just going to create a level. It will be parametric and you're going to be able to attach things to it. But when you create that level, it will not automatically create a top view. So floor plan, ceiling plan, side plan, structural plans, whatever it is. So if you want additional views to be created, you check this guy on, and then here under plan view types, you can select what kind of views you want to see created. So let's say, for example, that I don't want the structural plan and I don't want the ceiling plan. Let's say that I just want the floor plan for this one, just for funsies, right? So I'm going to come here, and now to draw your level, you can just click and draw. I'm a little bit of a neat freak, so I like all of my levels to be perfectly aligned. So if you want them to be aligned, you can just come here. See, when you go to the end of the level, it automatically kind of like snaps into place. When you're setting up a level, you can type in the distance that you want that level to be. But keep in mind, like, I don't know if you're noticing, but the distance that I'm getting for my level is the distance from the closest level. So it's not measuring from the AFF, which is 0 feet. It is measuring the distance of this new level from the closest level, which in this case would be my underslab. So let's say that I want this level to also be 8 feet. So I can go 8 feet, enter. And now there is my level. And now I just need to click a second time to place it. And as you can see, I want you to notice a couple of things. First thing first, if I go on my views, you're going to see that now there is a new level, which is called UT. Now, this name is interesting. I think it is picking up on the previous name. This is something funny that can happen depending on how you name. So, for example, if I would have named my levels level one, level two, the next level that I would have created would have automatically been level three. So I think it's just following up on the letters that because I typed US instead of underslab. Okay. But what I want you to also notice is that despite the fact that the height that I wrote down here was 8, the number that my level is showing is 16 feet. And that is because levels show values always from 0. So they are counting 0, 8, 16, and so on and so forth. You can measure levels individually. So like, for example, if I select on this guy, I'm going to get this. This is what we refer to as temporary dimensions. And these are adjustable. So see, right now, this dimension is measuring the height between those two levels. So if my client comes to me and tells me, oh yeah, no, it's not going to be 8 feet. I want it to be 10 feet. Instead of me having to do the math, which would be like 8 plus 10, I'm lazy, I don't want to figure it out, I could come here and just say, hey, this is supposed to be 10, enter. And then that's going to add up here. Okay, so you can determine the height of a level two different ways. Either you're working with the overall height of the building as a whole, or you can work with the height of the in-between levels, so to speak. And again, you can have levels that go up and you can have levels that go down. So if I go back to LL, let's say now that I want to have a basement, and let's say that I don't, or foundations, and let's say that I don't want to have any plans attached to this level. So I'm going to check it off. And now I'm going to come here and say, let's say that this is going to be, again, 8 feet. And I'm going to come here and move it this way. And then again, click to place it. And there is my, yes, it's like STU. It's picking up on that. Now, I want you to notice another interesting thing. These levels are blue. This level is black. The reason for the color difference is because black indicates that there is no view attached to this level, while these ones here do have views attached to them. So very interesting how Revit uses visual cues to inform you of what is going on. So what other modifications can we do to our levels? Well, first thing first, you can change the length of them. I'm finding that this level is a little bit aggressively large. So if you want to change the extent of your levels, you can do that by selecting them and dragging them at the ends. You can see that there's two like little points. Now, one nice thing of having all of your levels aligned is that then when you go to change one of them, you can actually change all of them. And I live by the mantra of work smart, not hard. If I move one of them, I want to move all of them, right? So I can do that here, bring them, and there you go. It gives me a little bit more control. Another thing that I want to point out about levels is that you can decide where this information is. So by default, it is always going to appear on your second click. So if you're clicking from left to right, it's going to be on the right side. If you click from right to left, it's going to be on the left side. But if you change your mind, you can always change it. One thing that I really like to do is if I'm working with a really, really large projects that are like very long, so to speak, I like to have the level information at the beginning and the end. So that way you don't, you know, kind of get lost in the sauce halfway through. So if you want to do that, what you're going to do is you're going to click here and see this little checkbox here. So if you check it on, it shows the level. If you check it off, it doesn't show the level. So see, you can change your mind, you can switch, or you can have them show on both levels. I would say that you don't want to have it not show on any levels, because then it's like, what is the point of having levels? But I do like being able to control on which side it shows. Finally, the last thing that I want to show about levels is what to do when we have overlapping information. So let's say, for example, that I have my level 00, and again, this is fly. So let's say that I have my level 00, and this is my actual grade, that's where my soil is, and then let's say that the actual slab where my main level is gonna be 12 inches above grade, so 1 foot above. So if I go LL, I'm just gonna come here, and I'm gonna measure 1 foot, enter, and I'm gonna put my level here. So the problem that I have is that these two guys are overlapping to the point where I cannot read the text. And this is a really big problem, because one thing that people sometimes miss the point about is the fact that data is useless if you cannot read it. So clarity is important. You need to be able to see the things that you need to see. So these two levels here are doing nothing for me because they're overlapping each other and they're not letting me see the information that I need. So if you're in this situation, what you can do is you can use the Harry Potter break. So whenever you select a level, I'm going to zoom in so we can see it pretty clearly. There you go. Right here in the middle. I don't know if you can see it. It's right under the slash. There's this little Harry Potter lightning break. And this is going to basically allow you to break the level. So see, now I get these two nodes. I have this node here and I have this other node. And if you click and drag on them, they're basically going to allow you to reposition your level information. The level itself needs to stay where the information should be. You cannot say like, oh, I'm just going to put this guy higher because it's in the way. The level line has to be where the level is. But the information itself can be somewhere else. So see, I can basically put it very nice and clean and organized. So see, now I can very easily read, yes, this is my AFF level and this is my other level. Okay, so to wrap up with levels, I just want to quickly mention the different uses that you can give to levels. So obviously the most obvious is going to be slabs. So again, this is going to be your floor and your roof. You can also sometimes use levels for ceilings, especially if you have a significant plenum. So let's say that you're running your HVAC, your plumbing, your electrical, you're running all of that through your plenum. You can put a level on your ceiling. So that way you can basically measure like, well, things are going to be this distance from my ceiling, so to speak. Levels are also very helpful when you have multi-levels within the same level, basically like a sunken level. So like, you know, you have your slab and then it goes down a couple steps. You can use a level to indicate that, but you don't necessarily need to have an entire separate floor plan for that, which takes me to the last thing, which is purging your levels on your project browser. Because the thing is that by default, so I'm going to get rid of all of these other levels that I created, and I'm going to keep just the two that I started with. So I'm going to get rid of this guy. I'm going to get rid of this guy. And when I go to get rid of this guy, you're going to get a message. Because remember, this level that we created here, we created associated views with it. And basically what Revit is telling me is, hey, if you delete that guy, the views go with it. So this is important. You can have a level without views. You cannot have the views without the level, okay? So in this case, I want to get rid of it, so I'm just going to say, okay. So now going back to the two levels that I started with. What I want to point out here is the fact that you don't necessarily need all of the views that are created here. Because again, in the context of Revit, Revit is always assuming that your level is a floor level. So because of that, every floor has a ceiling. So it's basically giving me a floor and a ceiling for level AFF, and then it's giving me another floor and another ceiling for my under slab. But I don't really need that. Technically speaking, I don't even need the floor plan for level two. Maybe if it would be like an actual roof so I can make my roof plan. But because here I am operating under the assumption that this is just a portion of a building within like a bigger context, I only really need the floor plan and the ceiling plan for my level one. So you can actually get rid of those views that you don't need. So I can go to my level two, right click and delete. That's it. No harm done. You can always bring back those views if you need them. Don't panic. It's not gone forever. You may lose like if you have specific annotations or something like that, but the data is there. And then let's get rid of also the level two ceiling plan. So right click and delete. And there we go. Finally, I'm just going to quickly address the fact that the same way that you can change the name of your levels, you can change the name of your plans. Now, level one is fine, and I may not change it for the time being. It works. But if you are not super happy, you can change it to main level or generic or general or construction, just kind of like a basic generic name that is used for kind of like what's going to be your main plan. So in my case, I'm going to rename. So right click and instead of delete, you rename. I can rename this guy to general, my general. And just to be super clear, let's call it general floor plan. Beautiful. And I'm going to do the same thing with my ceiling. Right click, rename, and general ceiling. Oh no, even better. Let's just call it RCP, reflected ceiling plan. You may find it funny that it took me a stupid amount of years to figure out that it was reflected ceiling plan and not reflective ceiling plan. This is going to basically be the setup for the project that I am going to be developing in the coming videos to introduce you to the rest of the Revit basic tools. You're just going to need one level for the bottom, one level for the top. It's going to be a nice little sandwich with a lot of interior design going on in between. But with that, we have reached the end of this video. I hope you found it helpful. If you have any questions, by all means, feel free to add them in the comments. If you like the video, it would be really nice if you like it. Also super nice if you subscribe. But otherwise, thank you very much for joining in. Thank you very much for sticking through, and I will see you in the next one. Have a good one. Bye.